Hello and good morning. I hope that you are doing well. Just a quick reminder that you can stay engaged during this service by using the chat box. You can say hello, you can type amen, you can even share your prayer requests during the prayer time. So again, that's one way to remain engaged during this time. Now keep in mind that some people are watching on Facebook, some on YouTube, some in real time, and some watching replay. So don't be discouraged if there's not an immediate response to your comment, but know that people will see your comment as the service goes on. Thanks again for joining us, and may God's peace be with you.
Alabado sea el Señor, alaben a Dios en su santuario, alabenlo en sus majestuosas bóvedas celestes.
Praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in His mighty heaven.
Alábenlo por sus hechos poderosos. Alábenlo por su grandeza infinita.
Praise Him for His mighty works. Praise His unequality and greatness.
Alábenlo con toques de trompeta. Alábenlo con arpa y salterio.
Praise Him with a blast of the ram's horn. Praise Him with the lyre and harp.
Alábenlo danzas al son de panderos. Alábenlo con flutas e instrumentos de cuerda.
Praise Him with the tambourine and dancing. Praise Him with strings and flutes.
Alábenlo con platillos sonoros. Alábenlo con platillos vibrantes.
Praise Him with the clash of cymbals. Praise Him with loud clanging cymbals.
Que todo lo que respira alabe al Señor.
That everything that breathes sing praises to Him.
Alábenlo sea el Señor.
Praise the Lord.
Welcome to this gracious time to experience together peace with God. This is Lombard Christian Reformed Church's live stream service of worship. My name is Tom.
And I'm Karen
Busack.
Our hope and prayer is that together we give thanks to God, our Father, for Jesus Christ, His Son, and our Savior. May the Spirit of the living God unite us together in the grace and truth of Jesus. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
I will give you all my worship. In the military, nobody doubts what's meant. When the order is given, halt, about turn, quick march. It means that the soldiers are being told to turn their backs on the direction in which they were going and to start marching in the opposite direction from the way they were going before. And that's what repentance is. You see, human beings, by instinct, and this is our fallenness finding expression, by instinct, we walk at a distance from God. And God says, turn round, face me, and walk towards me. The basic problem with fallen human nature is that we all want to be independent of God. God says, stop it. And the reason why the theme of repentance is neglected, as indeed it is, not only in modern secular society, but in the church, is because it's a costly thing to repent. It does mean reshaping your life in quite a radical way. And people, just because they find it too costly as a prospect, they try to devise a way of being Christian which doesn't involve anything as radical as about turn, quick march. And we who preach the gospel and seek to explain Christianity to folk, we, I think, have to take that as a challenge and talk a great deal more about repentance and the necessity of it than most of us do. The end, of course, of walking Godward is that fellowship with God becomes a real and rich reality more and more as one lives the life of repentance. And those of us who, by God's grace, have begun to learn to do it, testify, if asked, to the joy of the new life of being closer and closer to the Father and His Son, Jesus Christ. Until one begins to take repentance seriously, this is going to be a closed book to you. So I beg you, start taking repentance seriously. Will you do that?
And now let us confess our sins to the Lord. God of everlasting love, we confess that we have been unfaithful to our covenant with you and with one another. We have served other gods, money, power, greed, and convenience. We have served our own self-interest instead of serving you and your people. We have not loved our neighbor as you have commanded, and we have not rightly loved ourselves. And now I invite you to read these words as we continue to confess to the Lord. Forgive us, gracious God, and bring us back into the fullness of our covenant with you and with one another. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And now receive these words of assurance from Romans 5. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we now stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. This is what we believe, and this is what we receive. Thanks be to God.
Our Father everlasting. creating one, God Almighty, and through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus. Our judge and our defender suffered and crucified, forgiveness is in you. Descending into darkness, you rose in glorious light, forever seated high. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. Believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name.
Kids, one of the things we learned today is the more we know about God, the more joy comes to us, because it's just like knowing your best friend better and better. There's more joy in that. And so that's what this song is about. You are the light of my soul. It's about learning more things about Jesus, who's our Savior and our Lord and our best friend. So let me sing it through, and then we'll try it again, and then maybe you can join in, okay?
You are the light of my soul, O Lord. You are the candle in my life. You are the light of my soul, O Lord. You keep the flame burning bright. You are the one who lights my path. You lead me in the way of truth. You are the rock on which I stand. Forevermore I'll trust in you. Forevermore I'll trust in you.
Okay, kind of get it? Gonna join with me now?
You are the light of my soul, O Lord. You are the candle in my life. You are the light of my soul, O Lord. You keep the flame burning bright. You are the one who lights my path. You lead me in the way of truth. You are the rock on which I stand. Forevermore I'll trust in you. Forevermore I'll trust in you. Forevermore I'll trust in you.
Listen to the Word of God from Philippians 3, verses 1 through 14. We are reading through Philippians this summer and taking to heart its theme. The way to a joyful life is being friends together in Christ. The Holy Spirit's counsel in this paragraph is that joy deepens in communion with God. How would you describe communion with God? In what ways do you practice being close to the Lord? What hinders our closeness? Let's bring our questions to God as we listen. Philippians 3, verses 1 through 14.
Further, my brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. It is no trouble for me to write the same things to you again, and it is a safeguard for you. Watch out for those dogs, those evildoers, those mutilators of the flesh. For it is we who are the circumcision, we who serve God by his Spirit, who boast in Christ Jesus, and who put no confidence in the flesh. Though I myself have reasons for such confidence. If someone else thinks they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law of Pharisee, as for zeal persecuting the church, as for righteousness based on the law, faultless. But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained all this, or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Sisters and brothers, have a look at this picture. What do you see? Perhaps you've seen this famous optical illusion drawn by W.E. Hill way back in 1915. Hill titled this picture, My Wife and My Mother-in-Law. Most people will either see a young woman or an old lady, but seeing both takes patience and persistence. It's said that the older you are, the quicker you see an image of an old lady, the mother-in-law, and the young people have an easier time seeing the image of a young woman, the wife. So how old does this picture make you feel? What do you see? It's also said that once you see one image, it's very difficult to see the other. So have you seen two images, both the wife and the mother-in-law in the picture? Can you see it? So often, what we think we see isn't the whole story. All we see is that our life is stuck, or my life is miserable, or life scares me and overwhelms me, or I deserve to be happy. It's human nature to see only the human, earthly half of what is right in front of us. By the way, the eye of the mother-in-law, you see that? Becomes the ear of the wife. Can you see that there? Whose face is turned in profile, if that helps you. It's an important picture because it reminds us of good relationship advice, doesn't it? Take a good look at the mother before you marry the daughter. And that's helpful wisdom. But it's important for a spiritual reason. Communion with God has a lot to do with how we see things. And how we perceive things has a lot to do with our communion with God. G.K. Chesterton, writing The Man Who Was Thursday, writes, "Shall I tell you the secret of the whole world? It is that we have only known the back of the world. We see everything from behind, and it looks brutal. If we could only get round front." Philippians 3 helps us get round front. The passage begins with rejoice. This is about real joy, true joy, a holy happiness, even when pleasure fades and feelings of happiness are too weak for what we're facing in the moment. Rejoicing comes by a true way of seeing, perceiving, recognizing how Christ in your life changes the meaning and purpose of things, and what our goals are, what we really want to accomplish, because we now live by grace alone. Because of the cross and resurrection, Jesus is not only with Paul, but lives through his circumstances. Paul sees everything about life differently. He sees life correctly, and he finds his joy deepening. "This is how I used to think life works," he says, "and I was good at it. If someone else thinks they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. As for righteousness based on the law, I'm faultless." Before he met Jesus, what did he think of himself? Faultless. Full of confidence in his own ability to live the life he was meant to live and get to God and all the blessings he deserved. But once Paul takes to heart the meaning of the cross and the reality of resurrection, he doesn't lose confidence. He, for the first time, finds it in Jesus. Because the cross brings us strength, even when the worst happens, and resurrection promises the best to come. Paul cautions the Philippians who are tempted to head down the same path he used to walk. Some of the Philippian Christians were looking to add Jewish religious rituals like circumcision. Verse 2, he says, "Watch out." Verse 3, "For it is we who are the circumcision, we who serve God by his Spirit, who boast in Christ Jesus, and who put no confidence in the flesh." Perhaps for the Philippians, the temptation was it was a way to feel secure. Perhaps the thought was, in these hard times, maybe some religious experiences will help me feel closer to God or make God more real to me. But it seems there was another reason for trying to become more Jewish. Philippi was a Roman colony. Rome didn't know what to do with Christians, and that's one reason Paul was in jail. That's why it didn't look good for his future. But Rome, more often than not, left Jews alone. So the temptation was, let's do some Jewish things, then we're sort of protected. If Rome comes calling on us, we can say we're Jews. And how often don't we try to blend in just enough? How often don't we try to spin faith so we're accepted, so we fit in, or at least fit Jesus into our desires and our wants? How often don't we see what others have or what others do and think, how come I don't have that? Or how come I can't do that? Before he met Jesus, Paul thought life was about religious, moral, and personal accomplishment. And that's how you find happiness, satisfaction, accomplishing the goal of my life. And we are always in that danger today, of making our own happiness the ultimate goal in life. Parents of teenagers know this as a great temptation. You just want your teens to grow up to be happy, to find themselves, their one thing, their identity, their way to fit in and excel. So, as parents, you look to control your environment. Home life, school life, church and youth group life, life with God, even, in order to get this. A disordered desire within us tempts us to live as if we can have it all now, that we're going to have heaven on earth. To live that way, though, is to become a hoarder. And what we treasure is really only garbage. We mature in faith as we repent of grasping at being happy, desiring instead to rest in God's good. And those are different things. It starts by getting closer to Jesus, getting into deep communion with God. And that means moving away from confidence in the flesh, in my ability to control and shape things toward my perceived destiny. If Paul couldn't do it, you can't, unless you think you're more faultless than he thought he was. Now, Paul could see the cross and resurrection made sense of every loss. Jesus wasn't something to be used for Paul's own agenda and personal gains. Jesus was to be glorified in Paul's pursuit of holiness. Listen, I consider them garbage, talking about that old way of control, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ. Not my own right, not feeling secure in what I get right, gaining Christ, being made right by thinking, feeling, and acting, knowing the cross leads to resurrection and the new life Jesus gives brings joy. Paul understood even his best moral and religious accomplishments did not help him know God. Jesus did. And knowing Jesus this way finally brought sense to his past, present, and future. Verse 10, I want to know Christ. Yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death. This new way of seeing is also his way forward. Even now, while he is in prison, hurting, his life in jeopardy, and everything a question mark, he wasn't alone in this. This was participating with Christ in suffering. This wasn't a failure of his life or something to regret. This was knowing Jesus more deeply as he and his best friend shared this pain. This wasn't the final say about how disappointing he was as a person. This was the birth pain of new life. Because this is now the goal of life, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. This is our joy. Joy that doesn't separate happy days from sad days, or successful moments from moments of failure, experiences of honor from experiences of dishonor, sacrifice from resurrection. This joy is a divine gift that does not leave us in times of illness, poverty, oppression, or even persecution. It is always proclaiming that death or loss or hurt no longer has the final say, though its protests and threats remain loud and its devastation remains visible. The joy of Jesus lifts up your life right now to be celebrated. All this helps us let Jesus transform the direction of our lives. Paul moves from religious striving to trusting faith. so that Christ's righteousness, not his own success or security, becomes his goal. Life is not about using Jesus as one more resource to gain heaven on earth. It's seeing life differently, not about flesh that is securing my own goals and my own way through my own control and agenda, but by grace that is receiving each circumstance as an occasion to share in Christ's sufferings in order to know the joy of his new life. It's moving from writing my own story to belonging in Christ's story. Paul says this change from anxious, grieving, disappointed, unhappy, and angry living for fear of missing out changes to joy when we know Christ and we let Christ's knowing us change our desires. Verse 10, I want to know Christ. Yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death. I mean, if I'm Paul in prison, I want to know when I'm getting out of there. I want to know what my rights are. I want to know what I can do to defend myself. Paul says, no, look at it. Look at it from the reality of the cross and resurrection. I want to know Christ, because that will give me meaning and purpose and make sense of it and lead me to joy. The invitation is to commit to knowing God. And that's the title of J.I. Packer's classic book, Knowing God. Perhaps you have read it. I hope you have. Maybe you have. J.I. Packer passed away this past week. His teaching and Christ-like example in life blessed and formed many Christians. I read this book, Knowing God, way back in college in the 70s. And opening it up again, these words struck me as having stuck with me all these years. Through all the blessings and all the sorrows and all the strivings of life and faith and ministry. He writes, what is the best thing in life? Bringing more joy, delight, and contentment than anything else? Knowledge of God. We are cruel to ourselves if we try to live in this world without knowing about the God whose world it is and who runs it. And this, if you ask, why is this happening to me? No light may come. But if you ask, how am I to glorify God now in this? There will always be an answer. Seeing differently because of knowledge of God. So with what's left of this summer, let's challenge each other to read a deep, reflective, classic Christian book to gain a greater knowledge of God. A book like this, Knowing God by J.I. Packer, that's one. But maybe you've always been meaning to read Calvin's Institutes or Augustine's Confessions or Jonathan Edwards' Religious Affections. There's probably no better time. Or C.S. Lewis's Mere Christianity, Ragamuffin Gospel by Brennan Manning, How Now Shall We Live by Chuck Colson. There's plenty of classics out there that will deepen our knowledge of God. They're waiting for you. Now's the time. We have time yet this summer. How about one? Or Celebration of Discipline by Richard Foster or Bonhoeffer's The Cost of Discipleship. Or Philip Yancey's What's So Amazing About Grace, or Simply Jesus, or Simply Christian by N.T. Wright. Or perhaps a book from our own Christian Reformed tradition, Lewis Smead's Forgive and Forget, or Neil Planning's Not the Way It's Supposed to Be, or You Are What You Love by James K.A. Smith. Pick one of these with a friend, and then talk about what you've learned. Let's make the most of this time yet, because as we grow in our knowledge of the Lord, we gain a better eyesight into God's use for what we're going through and God's purpose for our future. as our knowledge of Jesus grows, so he gives us joyful desires, not for the fleeting pleasures of today, but for eternal joy. Paul says in verse 12, not that I have already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus takes hold of me. He's talking about reordering his life around the desire, that first foundational best desire to live with his best friend and his life and his Lord Jesus. One experience of faith is that our desires and affections are changed for the better by our knowledge of the cross of Jesus and his empty tomb. Not just thinking, not just head knowledge, but applying this grace and truth to our circumstances and then acting and feeling in the way Jesus and our Christian friends and fellowship act and feel towards all those occasions and circumstances of life. When I share in another's pain or hurt or loss, I experience God in a new way, that kind of experiential knowledge. Like, you know, after you graduate and you're looking for a job and you have the requisite education, but you get frustrated by HR interviews that ask, but what experience do you have? That kind of knowledge that only comes through devotion, trust, waiting on the Lord, shared sufferings, and promised covenantal action. When we do things simply because God says so. That's knowledge Paul talks about here that adds to our meditation on God's word and transforms our desires. Ruth Haley Barton says this: you might think that your woundedness or your sinfulness is the truest thing about you. You might think that your giftedness or your personality type or your identity as husband or wife, mother or father somehow defines you. But in reality, it is your desire for God and your capacity to reach for God that is the deepest essence of who you are. The thing is, if we don't offer our desires before the living Word of God, our desires will be shaped by other forces, other relationships. Thousands of messages coerce you every day to live for yourself, to live for now, to live to be happy, and these crowd out an ability to desire God's good. Our hopes and dreams are shaped for the better by taking to heart God's word. So, how's your Bible reading and meditation going this summer? Are you keeping it up? There's time to get back to it. Take your Bible outside and read. Maybe read through the whole book of Philippians at one time. Or pull out a little passage that we've talked about, or one that's a favorite of yours, and just read it over and over. Read it in the context of what you're going through right now. See your circumstances through God's word instead of just your feelings. Taking a long and trusting second look at our circumstances can change everything. Does Paul sound like a man desperate and angry about how life has turned out? He's more joyful than we are. He doesn't know what will happen to him, but he rejoices in his future, confident of how right this is for him in his love from and for Jesus. Don't you want to live like that too? This wasn't just theory for Paul. Over and over, he's seen it happen in himself and in others. He knew living for happiness instead of God's good was a dead end. You might have pleasure, but you won't have God. It's like the optical illusion we started with. Our first look wasn't the whole picture. And in finally seeing Christ with him, Paul saw the grace and truth of it all. He could press on with a new desire to live in the joy of Christ's love. Our joy deepens in this kind of communion with God. Amen. Sisters and brothers, let's come now to God in prayer. Eternal God, though I cannot see you with my eyes or touch you with my hands, yet grant me this day a clear confidence of your reality and power. Do not let us go into this week's work believing only in a world of sense and time. But give us grace to understand that the world we cannot see or touch is the most real world of all. Our lives today will be lived in time, but eternal issues will be concerned in it. The needs of body will make themselves known, but it is for the needs of our soul that we must care the most. Our business will be with physical things in the days you give us, but behind them, let us be aware of spiritual things. Let us keep steadily in mind that the things that matter are not money or possessions or houses or lands, not bodily comfort or bodily pleasure, but truth and honor and meekness and helpfulness and a pure love of yourself. For the power you have given us to lay hold of things unseen. For the strong sense we have that this is not our home. For our restless heart, which nothing finite can satisfy, we give you thanks, O God. For the invasion of our souls by your Holy Spirit. For all human love and goodness that speak to us of you. For the fullness of your glory poured out in Jesus Christ, we give you thanks, Heavenly Father. We give you thanks as we count our blessings, for your daily provisions, for the joys of relationships and creation, for moments of laughter and love, for the peace of Christ, which the world can neither give nor take away. And so we offer up to you with thanks the blessings we have received. We celebrate with Marty and Joan Hoekstra their 70th anniversary at the beginning of this month. We're thankful for those who have found jobs and pray you lead those who are still looking for work to find employment. We pray for continued protection for those whose work puts them at risk regarding the coronavirus. And we ask prayers for healing mercies for those on our hearts today. For Nick Tooney and Veronica Tooney, each having contracted COVID-19. Continue to restore Karen Busack and Bernice Boringa after each suffered broken bones because of a fall. Guide Pat Serrano's doctors as they decide on treatments for her since her cancer has come back. And continue to be with George Taminga, Barb Van Staldinen, Rick Hopp, Lenore De Bruin, and Ginny Jupp, and all those with ongoing or chronic conditions or illnesses. Pray for Patty Hopp, who's got a blood clot in her foot, and pray that if procedures go forward, that she may find healing and strength as well. Lord, we are journeying towards eternity. Today we stand before you in time. Do not let us seek to deaden or destroy the desire for you that you have planted within us with cheaper, lesser loves. Make us wise to see all things today in your presence, in all circumstances as invitations to your cross and to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Make us brave to face all the changes in our lives, knowing that you are changing us for the better and fitting us not for glory here, but for the glory of eternal life in heaven with you. And so hear our prayers in the name of Jesus, our eternal Lord. Amen.
This week's offering is for Hope's Front Door Ministry. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for Hope's Front Door Ministry, that they may continue to help those in need. Thank you that our congregation can support such a caring organization. Please bless this offering and the workers, volunteers of Hope's Ministry. In Jesus' name, amen.
With your help and support, Hope's Front Door was able to meet and exceed our $20,000 goal. Over $21,700 was raised to help over 3,000 adults and children for our Lend a Hand fundraiser. As we all face new challenges related to COVID-19, there is no doubt we are all in this together. Here at Hope's Front Door, with your contribution, we are able to offer curbside services of basic need items like food vouchers, transportation vouchers, prescription medication, and medical supplies. Hope's Front Door is one of the few area organizations to provide assistance with prescription medication. And being able to access medication is crucial because a substantial number of our clients have underlying health issues like high blood pressure, diabetes, asthma, and cancer, which make them more at risk for more severe illness from COVID-19. With your help, we will be able to assist people needing these essential items. We know that for many families in the community, financial recovery from COVID-19 will be a marathon and not a sprint. Hope's Front Door anticipates assisting an elevated number of clients during the next 12 to 18 months as they work to get back on their feet and stabilize their households. So, we thank you for your support and sending the message that our efforts today will help us overcome, together, the challenges we face in the COVID-19 pandemic.
So, brothers and sisters, today was all about seeing differently because of Jesus, seeing truthfully and gracefully that what's happening in our lives is directed by and brought to glory by Jesus Christ. And so I hope that you could take this now as you go and have your eyes open to see differently, whether that be a great blessing that is before you or a heavy cross to bear. So now let us go in the blessing of God and the peace of Christ. And if you're able, and if the weather holds, we'll see you tonight at 6 o'clock for our evening regathering time of worship. Brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Go now in the joy of knowing that you have been included. Included at the table. Included at God's table. Included in our common life. Included in the life of God. In the life shared by the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Let's sing, sing. let's sing for joy, for joy, for joy.
Go in the joy of knowing that you have been included in the inner life of the God who is love. Go, find joy in telling others that they too are included.
May God be gracious to us, make his face shine down. May God be gracious to us, and make his ways known. Let's sing,
go, find joy in bringing all to God's table. Do not be afraid, for God has chosen gladly to give you the kingdom. You are included.
May God be gracious to us and make his face known.